Very good afternoon, one and all. And today we have with us Dr. Dhanya, who is assistant professor at Central Center for Environmental Science and Technology at School of Environment and Earth Sciences, Central University of Punjab. And she did PhD in environmental science in 2011 from the Indian Agriculture Research Institute, New Delhi, where she was as a DST Inspire Fellow. And she also did his master's in environmental science in 2007 in Indian Agriculture Research Institute, New Delhi, ICRJRF. And she was also a gold medalist there. And she did BSc in agriculture. So she has a combination of agriculture and environmental science background. And she handled various projects during his research tenure and during the MSc. There are a number of research articles and review article on her name. And she published almost seven book chapters in different journals. She also published one book in 2012, and there is some of the popular research article also there on her name. And she attended various conferences and you know, organized different seminars. Since 2011, she has she is working with Central University of Punjab. And if I talk about research grant, she received UGC Research Startup Grant for newly recruited faculty, as well as Central University of Punjab Research Seed Money for her research work. And there are other achievements, like she was Inspire Fellow during PhD, then awarded with a gold medal in Masters, awarded as IARI Merit Medal for MSc program, and there are more others. So I'll not take much of her time, and I welcome you on behalf of Shishti and Honeybee Network. Over to you, Dr. Dhanya.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta, and I'm thankful to Shishti. And good afternoon, students. I got that information that you, all of you are undergraduate students, with few are from other background. The others I have seen, they are from biotechnology background. So if possible, some responses I expect from you. It's not a one-way talk. It should be an interactive. I prefer to be that way. And in today's discussion, we will be discussing on the applications of microbes in environmental management. So, my next slide is not visible.
No.
Yeah, now it's okay. Mm-hmm. It takes some time, so it's okay.
Yeah.
Do you think the microbes have any role in the environment? Definitely, yes. I think you have came across many functions of microbes with respect to different aspects. But in this discussion, we will be more focusing on the environment. So we will keep this question there and we will move on to this global environmental issues. I hope most of you are having a course, a basic course on this environment science. So you may be aware that there are many environmental issues globally. We should start from locally, local, regional. Then you have at your state level, your national level and international level. So mostly whenever we say the issues, so the first thing come to your mind is climate change, global warming, climate change. And with respect to that, many impacts are there, consequences are there, is it? Then the next one is your pollution. The pollution may be in any of the metrics of environment, like water, air, soil, etc. Then comes the biodiversity loss. Your natural resource degradation, that is depletion of the natural resources. And the recent one, not recent, I should say, the other one, which is also getting that issue, which is becoming a concern, is the waste management. Apart from this, you may also heard about acid rain, ocean acidification, ozone layer depletion, like that. But with respect to your microbes, we are going to connect it. Do you think these microbes have any role in solving these issues? Or whether they are playing any role to maintain the balance of ecosystem or your environment? So this is the basic thing. Knowingly or unknowingly, the nature has its own way to balance or make the equilibrium within our nature. So in that, what's a microbe? Where you place the microbes in an ecosystem? Or you can say, what is the trophic level of a microbe? Where you will be placing? I hope you are not able to answer, though you want to. So anyway, we can keep, you know, you are having three levels, is it? You are having the producer, you are having consumer, and you are having decomposer. When we say microbe, mainly it comes to our mind is the third one, that is the decomposer. But this microbe also have a role in the other levels also, especially in the autotrophic, your producer level also, it has a role. Now, what is this microbial habitat where they are finding or where they prefer to be? So you can say that microbes are everywhere. It's there in the terrestrial ecosystem, in the aquatic ecosystem, then even within the organism. It may be on the surface or it can be inside the organism, playing different roles. Now, this microbial ecology deals with the interactions and their functionalities, physiologically as well as other functions of the microbes with respect to different things. You can see here the microbes. So they have a role there, and there is a two-way process. You can say the interaction is the environment interacts with microbes, or you can say based on the requirement or environmental conditions, you are having microbes there. And these microbes also helps in two. It not always not helping. It can be beneficial as well as harmful. You know about the interactions can be positive and negative interactions. So here the microbes can be involving in positive way, like your mutualism, symbiosis, and like that. And similarly, it can also harm. So you are having the both. You can have synergistic effect, you can say, and antagonistic effect also. Now, so these are the roles of microbes in the environment. So first one, you can say it is very much involved with the biogeochemical cycle, like your carbon cycle, nitrogen cycle, phosphorus, sulfur, and other micronutrient cycles. Among that, the most important one is your nitrogen fixation. You know about the biological nitrogen fixation. So with that biological nitrogen fixation, the other parts of the nitrogen cycle goes on. And the second important role is it's with respect to environment, okay? So here you are having the pollution abatement. So whatever xenobiotics are there, there may be or there are some organisms you will be getting for removing or to degrade that pollutant. So it can be degradation or it can be remediation. It can be complete way or it can be partial. Then this one, your waste management. Nature has its role, I told you. So decomposition. You know, if you keep anything, any organic matter outside, so it will undergo rotting process. So it's a nature's role. So here the organism, the microbes play that role to manage that waste. And further, it is also used in a sustainable agriculture. So here it is not you are having it naturally because there is an interaction of plant microbe. This one, we are making use of growing the crops. I think you are having some lectures in the coming series. So it will be more clear there. So here you will be this environment-based thing. You are having the recycling of the nutrients as well as you will be suppressing the diseases and the pathogens as well as your pest. And further, it is also involved in the land reclamation. Okay, we will see it few in this discussion because this one, environmental microbiology is a wider topic. We cannot cover it in 1 hour, but I just want you to give a glimpse of those things. Most of you are aware of it. Some may be some few points may be new to you in this discussion, coming to things. So what do you mean by this environmental management? So still now we have seen the background. What are the issues? What are the roles of these microbes, etc.? Now coming to the environmental management. So the roles which we have played, which the organisms, the microbes are playing, is related with the management of the environment. It is a systematic approach, okay, for this management or the control of the interactions and impacts. Why this is needed? Because our own activities. We are the root cause for all the environmental issues. So because of that issues, we are causing the problems to others, especially to the nature, especially to the environment, ecosystem, other organisms. So here, it's systematically we are managing in the environmental management part. Now coming to the sustainability, you can say that it is the successful management of resources. When there is a successful management, then only the sustainability comes. So what you have already heard about, what is sustainability? It's a balanced way of environment, economics, and the society. So this one is to the sustainability is successful management of the resources to satisfy our needs, that means present needs, along with maintaining or enhancing the quality. That means we are not compromising our future. Okay, so if you are doing like this, it will be under sustainable. Now we can classify this diversity, microbial diversity functions, into three groups. What we have seen as the role, we can classify them under these three categories: protective, and regulatory. You may be heard about the values of biodiversity. It can have direct values and indirect values, is it? So direct values means protective. So you know, the protective part mainly deals with the products. That means it is mostly linked with the industrial microbiology. Okay. Or in environmental sustainability also, we are depending on some products which are of sustainable nature or which can lead to sustainability. But the others, you can say that is protective and regulatory. It's there in the nature. So this is more important for your environmental management. These are mainly your indirect values. So protective values, you can value it with the product, what it is producing, but protective and regulatory, you cannot assess with respect to the economic value. But nowadays, this environmental microbiology that also linked with industrial microbiology, it is not alone, okay? So here, the first one we will be seeing, that is microbes in the pollution control. So here, what principle is used? Before that, you know, these are the different sources. You have many, but the major sources are industries, automobiles, and agriculture. Agriculture means the waste generated after the harvest, you can say. Industries, you know, it is a major pollutant. It is polluting the air, your water, your soil, etc. And automobiles with a fossil fuel combustion, it is also emitting the gases, especially. So here, automobiles don't air pollution. If you see the microbe use of the microbes for the pollution control, where it is majorly used. Can we use that for controlling the air pollution? Basically, the air, we can say the microflora, which is present in the air, or the control of the air pollution by the microbes is a little bit difficult. So, but there are some research are there, but here we are more focusing on with respect to our microbes, specifically we are culturing it and we are growing it. So you are more into the liquid, that means your solid as well as soil pollution and the water pollution are mainly you can control or you can remediate the pollution with the help of the microbes. So these are the major industries which pollutes the environment. Or you can say these are as per the CPCB, you may be heard about CPCB, that is Central Pollution Control Board. They have notified some industries. Yes. Somebody is saying something. Excuse me. Is it okay? Shall I continue?
Yeah. Student, okay. Okay.
Somebody, I thought that some questions or something they may be asking. So that's why.
Yeah.
Okay, it's okay. Fine. So these are the major industries which I told you that are polluting or they're producing effluents and waste. Okay. So the paper and pulp industry, distillery, tannery, which is leather industries, petroleum industry, food and beverage industry, the pesticide industry, dye, pharmaceuticals, thermal power plants. How these thermal power plants are there? How they will be polluting? You may be heard about fly ash. So this, especially the coal-based thermal power plants. Nowadays, the government has asked to close most of the coal-based power plants where the grade of coal is very low. And they are shifting to biomass-based thermal power plants. Okay. And the thermal, this heavy metal based industry means with respect to your this electroplating, your zinc plating, then iron industry like that. It is related with the heavy metals. So you may be aware that there are different types of bioremediation, ex situ, in situ and other things, is it? So it is the with the help of organisms. Here bioremediation means it can be your plants also. But here, what we are saying is mainly with respect to your microbes. So it is the removal of the synobiotics with the help of the microorganism with the different processes. So you are having many. These are some of them. Biodegradation, biostimulation, sorption, then bending, biosparging. Maybe you may be already studied. Okay, so this one here, what we are mainly taking care is, I think you had some hands-on training on screening also. So here we will be looking for those. It can be native strains or it can be the one which have already identified. So indigenous, it can be indigenous or it can be the exotic one, but with the capability to remediate that. So with help of introducing some or supplementing some nutrients, your oxygen and other sort of stimulation, we are trying to increase their activity or improve their activity to remove your pollutants from that matrix. Okay. So here, this is a common, this is the natural leaf, which is present based on the rhizoremediation. So that is you can see the microorganisms have an interaction with the plant roots, especially. So they will be there and with different rhizoremediation and rhizodegradation method, they will be destructing or degrading the pollutants there. Now, coming to this biogeochemical cycling. Okay, so we have seen the pollution control with respect to bioremediation. I haven't given a different the scientific way, the other things, because you are undergraduate students. So I'm just giving the outline only. So here in the biogeochemical cycle, this is a complete way. Okay, so you can see here this carbon cycle. You can link that with nitrogen cycle. You can link it with sulfur. Do you think you have a microbial cycle for P? Phosphorus, potassium. So you know about the macronutrients and micronutrients you are having with respect to the plants, especially we have 17 essential nutrients. Out of that, you have around 7. Is it 7? Yeah, 8. You know about CHO. Then you are having NPK. And you are having calcium, magnesium, sulfur. So now you are having 9, but I told you this, out of this 9, 2, your hydrogen and oxygen, we are getting, or the plants are getting abundantly, and they are not considered as macronutrients. So then you are having the 7. Otherwise, your macronutrients are 9. And you are having the micronutrients like iron, zinc, like that. So you can see here, the microbes are involved in everything. But yeah, you cannot see K here. So that means potassium. How you will be get the plants, how the plants are getting, or where, from where the plants are getting potassium. Maybe tomorrow's class you will be more learning those things. But in potassium, apart from few processes, the microbes are not directly involved. Okay. But in the case of nitrogen, carbon, and others, it is very much involved. Okay, so we have already seen this nutrient cycling is cycling and the availability is important to the plant point of view for the growth as well as the yield. It can be by fixation way or solubilization way. What is this fixation? You know about solubilization, especially with respect to your phosphorus and fixation. So this is nitrogen. Okay, so once it is fixed, then only the plants can take it up. So from, and here fixation, how it is related with your environment, environmental management. Though these are related with agriculture, but sustainable agriculture has a direct role to play with the environmental management. The first thing, your photosynthesis, the carbon dioxide. So the plants are taking it up. And you know about the carbon sequestration. Carbon sink, these terms may be familiar to you. So the microbes in the soil act as a sink for the carbon. So here with the help of this carbon, they are taking it up, the plants are taking it up and the microbes are decomposing it, and they are also through the respiration they are releasing this carbon dioxide. But it is in a cyclic manner. Okay, so there you are not getting any imbalance. But nowadays, you know that carbon dioxide emission is more and you don't have plants to take it up. That is another story. So here the microbes plays an important role in the nutrient cycling. So it will be in a closed cycle. Earlier it was a closed cycle. Now you will be getting some open cycles. And the microbial activity also gets affected. Now comes the biofertilizers, because you have seen the role of these microbes with respect to nutrient cycling and availability. So there the biofertilizer comes. So it's an integral part of sustainable agriculture. As I told you, you know about the conventional agriculture where the chemicals are used in a bigger quantity. Now organic farming came, but we all know that complete organic farming, shifting to complete organic farming is right now, it is impossible for country like India. So there comes the INM, that is integrated nutrient management, where your chemical gets reduced, or it can be a small part or some part can be replaced with the help of some other. And here, this biofertilizer, what is this biofertilizer? Is it only a product formulation, or it can be any live organism? So it can be live organisms also. Okay. So you know that the mode of application can be seed, root dip, or soil application. Now, what is their role? They are mainly meant for promoting the growth, especially that nutrient cycling and availability of the nutrients to the plant. So here, the role is how they are linked with biofertilizer, linked with environmental management. You are using the organism or you are using the product instead of chemical. And you know about the green revolution, is it? So during that green revolution, one was high yielding varieties, that was okay. We were using huge quantity of, or we, that plant required irrigation. That was also okay, but there are side effects like groundwater depletion and other things. And the third one is the use of chemicals. It may be in the form of fertilizers, or it may be in the form of your pesticides. So here, biofertilizer, this is an alternate to your chemical fertilizer. So if you are giving that, the plants, you are giving the manure or some other materials, organic materials which having nutrient. But there are some limitation with respect to this one. The bulkiness, you need in bigger quantity. So the right now the quality of the soil already degraded, and you have to restore that quality with the help of biofertilizer. And it may, in the coming time, it may be fully replaced, but not in the recent time. It is very difficult. Maybe in the coming time, the chemical fertilizers. But if the population is increasing like this, we cannot say that it will be completely replacing by the biofertilizer. But you should know that there are positive sides of biofertilizer with respect to the chemical fertilizer. The only thing chemical fertilizer which is having is your productivity. Okay, but in the case of sustainability, it is of no use. It is always having a negativity towards the sustainable. Okay, now you may be aware of different types of biofertilizer with respect to nitrogen, phosphate, like that. So this is different types of organisms. You know, this one, this nitrogen fixation is very much important. You are having symbiotic nitrogen fixation. You are having, it can be done by free, the non-symbiotic, free living organisms are there, microbes are there. This is only with respect to BNF, your biological nitrogen fixation, okay? So you are having some associative nitrogen fixers also, and some solubilizers and mobilizers are there. You are having, then you are having some, apart from this, you are also having some potassium solubilizing bacteria, which I was asking you. This is not a common thing, but there are some organisms. Sorry, this is not italics. So here you can have, there are some reports of the potassium solubilizing bacteria. If you are having the potassium fertilizer, or if the, especially in Indian context, that we are poor in potassium in the soil, and K is a major nutrient, and we normally get, or we normally put this muriate of potash, MOP, for this potassium to the plants. And so these are some other bacteria or some other organisms which are which biofertilizers, which are having this other apart from the nitrogen, phosphorus, and other things, silica, when you are having silicates, zinc solubilizing, etc. And you may be aware of PGPR. So you are also having some biofertilizers which is of PGPR nature, which improves the growth. Okay, and you also will also get the organic matter decomposing biofertilizers. So this is with respect to your organisms, how much nitrogen is fixed. You can see here the azolla. So mostly this is associated with the rice field, the azolla anabina. You may be heard. So this one, it's in the south where the water is available more. They are growing it in this fern, and it's some symbiosis with the anabina. They are capable of producing nitrogen, and they are used as an animal feed also. So okay, this is an important thing. This is cross inoculation group. Some of you may be aware. Rhizobium. It's a symbiotic which you have seen here. It's very important microorganisms or bacteria which is related with the nitrogen fixation. So there is a term cross inoculation group. So this cross inoculation group means this rhizobium is so specific to the host plant. So it has a symbiotic relationship with the legume plants. Here you can see one or two. In some group, you are having one or two crops and single rhizobium. So that one, this P group is a cross inoculation group which can infect, you know, this green pea and lentil. Infect in the sense they are able to nodulate and fix nitrogen. So this is the cross inoculation group where you can try with different plants, the same group. Okay. Now, the decomposition of organic matter is another related with the waste management. So we have seen sustainable agriculture. We have seen the some of the pollution control with the help of the microbes. And next is the decomposition. So you see, I told you that when you keep a heap of organic matter or your kitchen waste outside, it will undergo the rotting. Yeah, it's not necessary that you are keeping it outside. If you keep it in the kitchen also, after 1 or 2 days, it starts rotting and some smell will come. Here, this involves these four mainly. This decomposition means it can be photooxidation, leaching. It can be some decay with the growing of these organisms on the surface. And it can be mineralization, that is complete conversion. You know, there are two terms, mineralization and immobilization. So mineralization is converting to inorganic form. If you are organic into inorganic, and immobilization is you are converting inorganic to organic form. Okay. Especially if you are adding up the biomass to the body, the microbial biomass, if there is assimilating, so that is an immobilization. So they require the carbon and other nutrients for their biomass production. So you all know that the cellulose is the most abundant organic matter which is present in this earth. So this one is mainly it is present in the plant cell. The plant matter consists of three, majorly it is three components like cellulose, semicellulose and lignin. Now, this cellulose part, you see, there are three groups of microbes. You all know that it is related with the decomposition of cellulose is related with the cellulase, which is a mix of enzymes, and it's related with R selected copiotropic and K selected oligotropic. This copiotropic means they are grown in carbon rich environment, or you can say that they grow in excess of carbon area or location where they are getting enough or success. The growth will be more in those areas where you are having a surplus, you can say, surplus of your this carbon rich matter. While K selected, this one oligotrophs, these are mainly you can say that your acidophiles. They normally scavenge. They will grow in a low substrate area. Okay, so anywhere you can get this cellulose or cellulitic organisms with this three in these any of these three groups. Okay, now this is it's a table which shows the different composition of different your residues and other organic matter. So you are having cellulose degrader, hemicellulose, lignin degrader. Based on its the major, what this one, you know, it is a polymer made up of a monomer glucose. So you can say it is a homopolysaccharide. While this one is a heteropolysaccharide, where it has pentoses and hexoses in it. Lignin is also, it's basically substitute of your 4-hydroxyphenyl propanes, propanoids. Okay, so their composition are different. So their organisms acting on it also differ. And it is all based upon the enzymatic system. So the cellulase cannot act on lignin. The ligninase or your manganese peroxidase, that lactase and all, they cannot act on cellulose. So this is so specific. So your enzymatic system helps in the decomposition process. Now imagine a world without any microorganisms. So the bioremediation won't be there, it's fine. The xenobiotics will be accumulating. Now your decomposition won't be there. So you will be accumulating the waste. So nothing is happening to that waste. It's just heaping up. Okay, so if microbes are not there, it will be disturbing the entire food chain, food web, the entire ecosystem. You can say the biosphere itself, is it? So you are having four spheres of earth with atmosphere, lithosphere, hydrosphere, and biosphere. Now, in this biosphere, this sphere, which is having different organisms, they are present in all other spheres, but they are connected. And these microbes also play an important role in connecting these. And if one link is just broken or just disappeared, so they cannot connect, the others cannot be connected. So human beings, we are thinking that we are dominant and we can live alone. Nobody should be there. If we are alone, we can live with easy and all the convenience. But we can, without a single microbe, you see, this is small organism, tiny organism, and if they are not present, the entire ecosystem will be collapsed. But if it is vice versa, if human beings got extinct, it won't affect the other organism, is it? Now, so we were discussing about the composting and anaerobic digestion. So here the basic difference is aerobic and anaerobic. So composting occurs in the presence of oxygen. So the rotting, I told you, it can be in the presence of oxygen and it can be in the absence of oxygen. Mainly the rotting word, if I use, that is in the absence of oxygen only. Is it? So there will be, you are not get that for the decomposition, the oxygen is not enough. So that is anaerobic digestion. Now, we are making use of this microbes for the use or for the environmental point of view. If you are saying the composting, we are converting that to manure and we are adding that to your plants. And in the case of anaerobic digestion, so here the microbes are involved. And nowadays, we are making use of the microbes for the vermicomposting also with the worms, and enhancing that activity of the worms with the help of microbes. So here only this vermiculture, the worms, earthworms cannot do the decomposition process. For that, they require the microbes in it. Okay, so we are making use of that decomposition, which is happening in the nature in a controlled way to produce a product, which is useful to the nature. And in the case of anaerobic digestion, here, if you are keeping outside, or if you are not getting that enough oxygen, you are not giving enough oxygen, that will be producing methane, and that is released to the environment. Okay, so if that is releasing to the environment, if that is happening, this anaerobic digestion is happening in an open area, so what will be happening? You know that this methane is a greenhouse gas which has a global warming potential of 21. That is 21 times higher than of that your carbon dioxide. So that is released to atmosphere and it increases the warming potential. So here, this one we can convert, or we can divert, or we can, if you are making it in a controlled way, or if you are allowing that process to occur in a chamber or in a controlled way, you are collecting that methane and using it as a fuel. So thereby we are stopping the emission of methane to the atmosphere and reducing the global warming potential of that methane and converting that to a fuel. Then apart from that energy, you will also get manure from this. Okay, so that is a double, we are getting the two products from this one. Now, you may be heard about the bioherbicide also. So we are discussing the role of microbes with respect to different aspects of environment and management of environment, is it? So here, so the compost is there. So you can put it as the compost, you can use it as the nutrient source to the plants. So that replaces your, and I told you that manure, huh? You are in anaerobic digestion, which we were discussing here. So it's a manure is also produced here, and you are getting the fuel also. So here the biogas pen sludge, you can use it as a manure. So that also you will be adding to the agriculture, and you will be increasing the productivity. Here the bioherbicide. So what is its role? This is replacing or alternate to a herbicide. So you are having pesticide with different types, based on the use or against which you are using that chemical, is it? So here the bioherbicide, you can use different types of compounds, which is derived from microbes as well as plant residues also, okay? So here this bioherbicide, which we are discussing, is the phytopathogenic. So what is herbicide? It is that chemical or compound which kills the weeds. Weeds are those plants which are of no use, is it? So here we are making use of the microorganisms or their phytotoxins to control the weeds. So these are the commercial bioherbicides like Divine, Coligo, Biomar. So this is mainly derived from, these are the commercial ones which we have already available in the market. So Colletotrichum, you are having Phytophthora. So these organisms, from that they have produced this commercial bioherbicides, which has a potential to control the weeds. Okay, so these are the trade names of those this spores. Basically, they consist of spores from these organisms, these microbes, to control the weeds of the crops. I told you already the pollution control, is it? So here, the fossil fuel. We are saying this fossil fuel, you know that energy, we are depending upon the fossil fuel for the major part of our energy demand. It has it is good that for example, at your home, you are using LPG. For your car, you are using petrol. All these are fossil fuel. But you know that the combustion of this generates the different pollutants, is it? So these fossil fuel, they are mainly hydrocarbons. It can be aliphatic or aromatic hydrocarbon. So you are having oil, crude oil, is it? So the crude oil is one of the major pollutant, especially in soil and water. And they also emit gases to the air. So here, I told you that is aliphatic and you're having aromatic. Now, PAH is one of the noxious, you can say, pollutant. So there are different sources of this PAH, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, and your fossil fuel burning is major one. So it is released into these three phase, these matrices of the environment. It has the fate like this, and they remain there. Okay. So there comes the alternate for this, your fossil fuel, and biofuel is the nowadays you may be heard about this biofuel, and there are two types of biofuel, primary and secondary. Primary biofuel is the one which we were using from the ancient days, like your wood chips, your fuel wood, some pellets and all. But what we are discussing now, or in what we are listening to, the biofuel term is basically a secondary biofuel. Okay, so you are having secondary biofuel in four types: first generation, second generation, third and fourth. So here the generation, these generations are, this classification is mainly based on the source from which this biofuel is produced. If we are producing directly from starch, sugar, oil, then it is a first generation biofuel. Second generation are those which, if we are producing it from lignocellulose, and third generation are those if we are producing from algae, and fourth is basically we are taking the help of the genetic engineering, and we are converting that living organisms to produce these products. Now, how they are linked with the microbe. So this is the,
I'm open to questions right now. Like, I have a doubt in this particular thing, or should I ask it afterwards?
Can we complete it? You just note down your question and I will answer you.
No,
okay?
No problem.
Okay. Thank you. So this is the one which we are discussing, and here you are having different energy conversion routes like thermochemical, biochemical. Okay, mainly you can divide that, and you also having some chemical sort of thing where the biodiesel comes. So here in thermochemical, it's not related with your microbes, but here biochemical, where this one, anaerobic digestion and fermentation, this part is the microbial. It has microbes to play the role. Like we have already discussed the biogas, this anaerobic digestion. So organic matter in presence of anaerobic conditions, the anaerobic bacteria convert the organic matter to biogas, where it is a mixture of methane and carbon dioxide with other traces of other gases also. And the fermentation with the help of organisms, which is mostly in an aerobic condition. The one example is your bioethanol. So you are having the conversion routes of the biomass to different energy or different fuels, you can say. One example I told you, that is fermentation. So you can have ethanol, bioethanol, biobutanol, biomethanol. based on the organisms used for the production. So here you can see, here you are having the three different types of, or three generations. You are saying this one, I told you that sugar, if you are making ethanol from sugarcane, sugarcane juice, if I'm saying, so that is a first generation. While if I'm taking from sugar and starch, both comes in the first generation. And if I'm making it from the rice straw, wheat straw, your residues after the harvest, it will be having the second generation. And if you are making the bioethanol from algae, so it will be in the third generation. Okay, so this is how, and the organisms which are involved with this are mainly, if it is a bioethanol production, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, your this common yeast is involved. But here, if we are going for cellulose, you cannot use this Saccharomyces alone. Why? Because cellulose, first you need to saccharify that one with the help of some enzymes. Then you will be, the fermentation part, you can use this Saccharomyces cerevisiae if it contains only glucose. So cellulose is made up of glucose, it's fine. But if I'm saying lignocellulosic material, if I'm using rice straw, I cannot use this alone. I have to use some organisms which can convert the pentose sugars also. Okay, so this one is Pichia, Candida and all, they are capable of converting both. Okay, so this, the R&D is in this area, especially with this pre-treatment, then followed by this is there. Now, so we have seen the energy part, is it? So energy part means here, basically these two you cannot use in Indian condition. Why? We are having a huge, or we are, our population is so high, is it? So the number is so high and we need to feed them first, then go for the fuel, is it? So we cannot touch this part. But this one, which is agricultural residue, there are, we are an agrarian country and we have enough, or we have surplus this residues are there, so we can make use of this. But still, this is not commercialized. So maybe in the coming time, this scientists may come up with the this valid, you can say, excuse me, this commercial methods and all for the production of this biofuel from the second generation this thing. Now, all of you are aware that plastics are making a nuisance or to the soil and this water everywhere, is it? So even the life, the aquatic lives are more excuse me, aquatic life is affected more. So there are conventional methods for this plastic waste management, but you know, nowadays this microbial, you know that there are two parts in this plastic management. You can use some microorganism to remediate the plastic. Okay, so they will be there are some organism which has the capability to convert, or they may, they use that plastics to for their carbon source. Okay, and the next one is the bioplastic. So this one is the microbes. It is one of the one type of bioplastic. Okay, so you are having different types of bioplastic like starch based, cellulose based, then polyesters, then polylactic acids and all. So in that, some bioplastics can be produced with the help of the microorganisms, and one among them is the polyhydroxyalkonate. Okay, so why this is important? This one, if you compare the plastic and the bioplastic, okay, so plastic, you know, that is made from petroleum based products. So here you can reduce the use of fossil fuel, because we are not using the fossil fuel for the production, we are using the biomass, or you can say that renewable source of the source for the production. And the next important one with respect to environment is, there is, so here you can say there is less depletion, or they can reduce the resource depletion. Okay, here the second thing is that they reduce the greenhouse emissions. If you see here the carbon dioxide emission, this this one, this is basically with respect to the production. Okay, sorry. So here you are having this LDP, this is low density polyethylene, your polypropylene, like that. These three are your fossil based plastics. So you are having this much emission per kg polymer production. While this one, this I told you polyhydroxybutyrate, it is a bioplastic, polylactic acid is a bioplastic, and TPS, it is also a bioplastic. Okay. So here you see this as a, compared to this, this is less. This one, though, if you see this 2.5 and 2.6, they are nearby, but you see, this is only a report. Some report says that PHB production, you know, it's only a lab scale production. Now also in India, we don't have many products, but some products are available in the market, like disposable plates, the biodegradable plates, biodegradable cups and all, it's there in the market. So these bioplastics, they have mainly, the applications of this is mainly in the food industry, for the packaging and other things they are using. Then they are using in the medical fields, like a carrier. So they are degraded. Now you may be heard about the biodegradable the stitches and all. Okay, so earlier you have to take it out the after some time when surgery have the surgery, and they have to remove that the thread from the you know? But nowadays it degrade themselves, is it? So this is mainly with this biodegradable materials. So if you see, if you compare the toxicity and persistence, you know that your traditional, it takes thousands of years, you can say, for the decomposition, some types, okay? While if you see I told you these are the bioplastics, where their occurrence or they can degrade after few weeks, okay? So that is the biodegradability helps us to manage the plastic waste. And that is mainly with the help of the microorganism. Okay. So here the microbes are producing this type of plastics, and the degradation is done by the microbes itself. So biodegradable plastics are there. So till now we have seen different aspects of the management with the help of the microorganism. So all these comes under a bioprospecting term. Most of your research, maybe some of you have already started your final project or something. So we are exploring the biodiversity for the new resources or of some value, is it? And this is bioprospecting. So we are systematically searching for the products derived from the bioresource. And this can be plants, microorganisms, animals, etc. So microbial bioprospecting is a very, very good, R&D sector, you can say, for different aspects, like your industries, your environment, environmental microbiology is also there. So they are making use, or they are searching and they are improving the organisms for the products. But this one causes threats to biodiversity. Why? How the microbial bioprospecting causes threats to biodiversity? If we are harvesting in a bigger way, and you know, this one, mainly if you are talking about the threats to biodiversity with the help with this bioprospecting, you can say that this in microbes, you are culturing it and you can control. If you are not doing it in a controllable way, then it will be an issue. And especially in the case of plants and animals, this bioprospecting, if the over-harvesting makes a threat to the biodiversity, okay? So if you see, these are different types of bioprospecting. You can make use of this. So ultimately, if you see all this, you are having chemical prospecting, you are having gene prospecting, you are having bionic prospecting. So if these prospectings are doing in a very good way or proper way, then it can lead to environmental sustainability. So the products from this thing, it can be of less damage to the environment. You can design, you can make, you can model engineer those organisms or those products in such a way that that will be leading to the production development of that products without harming the environment. Okay, but there is a term which is related with this bioprospecting is biopiracy. Okay, so in our society there are, you know, about thieves, theft and other things. So this is basically a biological theft. So bioprospecting without recognition to the specific owners, you can say, if we are doing it, whether the knowledge from them or the materials from them without the consent or without giving recognition to the community where it is originated, it becomes a theft. So without, but if we are doing it in a proper way, bioprospecting has different different advantages or benefits. Okay. So we have seen different aspects of environmental management with the help of microorganisms, is it? So there are some laws made by, that is international laws, you can say, for the benefits. Okay, so one is your CBD. It's related with the Rio Declaration, where the countries which are rich in the biodiversity, they will be getting benefits. You know about there are two terms. One is biodiversity, and another is biotechnology. So some countries are rich in biodiversity, they may be poor in technology, like ours. And some countries, like US, they are rich in technology, but they may be poor in biodiversity. So it should be a balance. So the countries from where you can, what you say, the flow of biodiversity and biotechnology in both ways should be there. Okay, but nowadays what is happening? Only one way flow. Like you know about, I told you about the biopiracy. So US taking the materials from ours and they are patenting themselves and making use of it without claiming, without giving the recognition or the importance to the origin, the original place or where, from where they have taken, is it? So these are some laws which has given that right, okay? CBD, your conventional biological diversity is the first treaty. Then in India, we are having Biodiversity Act 2002 and the Nagoya Protocol, the equal sharing and benefits. So these laws are there to help the countries and the persons to take care of their resources. Okay. So these are some of the challenges and challenges with respect to the microbes, microbial use. Like there are biological constraint, you know it, their growing condition, some of you have started already, so the biological constraints are there. Some are so specific, sometimes the research which we are doing, we won't get the results, we have to repeat like that. And the conditions, environmental conditions means the temperature, because it's a biological thing, so microbes growing conditions are very much important. So there are constraints with respect to these the products and other things. Your technical constraints will be there. So we may not be doing or the what to say, the skilled labor sometimes required for this, different aspects and commercial limitations. If the product, if you have, for example, if I'm saying the biofuel, so you know that the commercial limitation is you don't have the market for that. For example, if I'm having bioethanol blended fuel, petrol, gasoline I am having, how many of you will be taking it? Though there are some mandatory, the government has issued some mandatory the rules to taking that one, but if the option is there, then we won't go for that. So there are the market demand and there are a limitation of this market is there, which limits the, or which is a challenge to the the major the your lab to land that final jo success of this products. Though we may be aware of the advantages of those, but purposefully we will be keeping it aside and we will be go for the conventional methods. So these are the this slide which where we are working, our team, my research team is working mainly. We are working on this solid waste management for this products, basically your bioplastics, then bioenergy like biobutanol, bioethanol. We are also working on the bioremediation part. So we are working on some eco-friendly products development for the sustainability in our lab. So thank you. So now I think we can have the discussion.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, why landfilling is included in waste management? Like by landfilling?
Dumping. You know, in waste, there is a hierarchy for the waste management. Okay, you may be heard about 6 R's. Suna hai?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So in that first one, kya aata hai?
That reduce, recycle, this.
Order mein hai. Order mein batao. Reduce, theek hai. Theek hai. So first we should reduce it. Then we have something, so we have to reuse it. Is it? So
yes,
order has a meaning. Okay. Reuse. Okay. Huh? Now reuse nahi kar sakte. Then we go for recycle. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Now the one which we have, for example, you cannot recycle. For example, plastic, glass, they can recycle. Is it? Huh? But for other things, for example, you are having kitchen waste. So there you cannot recycle. There you can go for the recovery, like in energy. Okay. So recovery, you can do it. Then for the final one is the rot. In the sixth one, the first starts with rethinking. Okay. So it's not starting with reduce. You can start with rethinking. That means whether I should go for that or not. So that starts there. Then the sixth one is rot. Rot is equivalent to your landfill. That is the least important option. Landfill. Landfill means dumping. What we are doing, garbage and other things. Na? So landfilling is the last option where we are dumping. Now, landfill, nowadays the municipal corporation and all, they are thinking that they are harnessing energy from the landfill. Landfill gas. Some have the plant nearby, so they will be making the biogas plant will be attached with that landfill, or they will be recovering that landfill gas from that landfill. You got it? So yes, landfill as such is not a good management option. It's the least important option. If you don't have any other option, then go for that landfilling. But nowadays, even if you are doing that landfill, because we cannot keep the organic waste at our home. So you have to fill it. For example, urban areas, cities, you don't have area. So you have to dump that, the garbage and other things. So you have to, that one, the I think you are basically from an urban area or this rural area?
I'm urban area.
Okay, so the Kudewala may be coming now?
Yes, ma'am.
So they may be asked you to sort the dry and wet waste, is it?
Yes, ma'am. But the thing is, like, they asked to sort it. But the thing is, like, think the management is not so proper. Like, they have the different boxes with them. But they themselves are mixing it. Maybe they don't know the...
they don't know. They are not different skilled labels. So they may be telling us and we may be doing, but ultimately they will put it in what? That is wrong. They should given proper training. So maybe in the coming time, it is one of the limitation of this thing. You know about different colored bins may be available. Huh?
Yes, ma'am.
So the residents may be putting it in the blue, green, red, means black, like that. So they will be putting it. Ultimately, the vehicle, it will be putting everything together. No sorting there. No? So it is one of the limitations.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
So, ma'am, as we have discussed, is the land farming an efficient waste treatment process? Like some companies.
So this is your name, please. Virupaksha. Virupaksha. Okay, Virupaksha. Okay. So land farming, we cannot say that is an efficient one. Why? Land farming, where it is occurring, it's for a water pollution or soil pollution. Virupaksha, what do you think?
Soil.
It's for soil, is it? So soil, if for example, if you are having a small polluted, small area is polluted, okay? Your oil spills and all, only in a small area. Then it is efficient. But you see, it's if it is a bigger area contaminated with that one, so the land farming, it takes time and the efficiency which we are expecting may not be getting. Okay, so in the lab scale or in that field study, you can do it. But in the real situation, there may be difficulties. Land farming is not so much effective.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, there can be issues like the contaminants mixing with the groundwater.
Yes, of course, yes. For example, for land farming, if I'm saying that area is polluted with your crude oil, okay? Some accidents occurred. The vehicle just that fell down or your the spills of that what happened, okay? So you are keeping that hydrocarbons are there. So it's there present in the soil. During rainy season, what happens? It will be moving in the runoff, you can say the seepage occurs and it will be moving. And the similar time, some other contaminants, they can move down. Downward and vertical and horizontal movement is possible. So it will be affecting both ways.
Okay, ma'am.
For the plastic degradation thing that we have researches which shows that Aedonitis is the bacteria which degrades plastic. Now, in the current COVID situation or the post-COVID scenario, what we are saying right, PP kit is the most, like it is the most important hospital managed waste, which is being all over the world, it is an issue. But the best thing, the thing about PP kit is, it is bacterial resistant.
Actually, so, PPE, it is bacterial resistant, but there are some bacteria which is capable of degrading that. Okay, you are having
in this case, yes, like, can we basically modify certain things or what could be the antibiotic resistance towards it?
Actually, for example, it's a good idea. Okay, PPE, you know that it is resistant to microbial degradation. Okay, but there are some bacteria which is having the potential, is it? It's there, okay. But the only thing is that if you are going for a bioremediation sort of thing, it takes time. Okay, that is also fine. But you know, even the report, the research says that it takes even some months also. You can modify it. That's what we are saying about the biotic. Okay, bionic engineering and all things we are saying, that prospecting. So you can search for that. That is R&D, okay? So you may be having one X organism with you. You can modify it genetically or different way, mutation and other things. You can modify and you can maybe in the future, you may be come up with one organism which is having this potential. You know about the Pseudomonas putida, is it?
So I wrote my BISS proposal in this context. This was my topic and I got selected for this on this thing. But so I'll be glad if I get your insights as an incubator.
It's okay. Whatever I can help you, I will do it. It's not a problem. Okay. You go ahead. Yeah. It's a good idea and you have to do it.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Excuse me.
Who is this?
Ma'am, this is Ayush, ma'am.
Ayush. Yes, Ayush.
Yes, ma'am. From last, I think 1 month from me and my team had started working on plastic waste management, ma'am. We have found a bacteria which can degrade plastic. And it was actually done in our college work only. And when I went through the research work done on that bacteria, I didn't found even a research till now where it proves that it can degrade PBA plastic. So might be a new characteristic of the bacteria might have
been. But it's okay. But you can go with your research. You may not be getting any research article.
Ma'am, that's what, ma'am. So I'm starting right now. For the beginning, I just have to prove that it can degrade the plastic. But
Yes.
So that which enzyme it is using, which gene is responsible for the production of the enzyme, how can we modify?
That is second part. First, you should go for whether that organism is able to use that. That is the first thing, okay? Enzymes and genes, that is second or third part, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So first
part is going
start
to be...
So you have already started your research or you are going to?
No, ma'am. I have started my basic research for the paperwork. Now, after my exams are going on right now, after exam finish, we are going to order the bacteria from pure culture and we are going to start the test of that. So,
okay.
Once we can...
So you are saying that you have identified from the review of literature some one bacteria, is it?
No, ma'am. Actually, it was done by our college student only. They actually did...
Okay. So now you were saying that you are going to order it. So I was confused there.
No,
okay,
ma'am.
You have already isolated...
Yes, ma'am. The student which they have done, they went for the bioinformatic test and they found out that particular bacteria.
Okay, they are going for identification, which you want to say. That they have the bacteria with them, they want to identify what bacteria, what species and general.
No, ma'am. The bacteria has been identified, ma'am. Everything has been done.
Okay. So you are using it for this. So isolating, they are not knowing what purpose, or they haven't seen with the plastic degradation. Yeah, it's.
Ma'am,
it's,
they
it's
isolated. They isolated. They performed it. It was they first found it as unknown bacteria because they were not able to do it. But after the experiment,
I was asking you, what is the rationale behind selecting that bacteria for your plastic degradation? So that's it.
Ma'am, now, actually it was the unfinished research, so I want to finish it in a complete way over there. So
no, that's okay. But whether they have started it or what is it? Because if you go with that, if they doesn't have any this potential, so it will be that your
ma'am,
research
they have
will
started
be...
it, they have done it, they have seen the result, they have mentioned the result, but they took it as an academic purpose. So the bacteria degraded the plastic in 60 to 70 days, ma'am. So they so now the thing is, ma'am, for the second level of research, which I need to find out the enzyme and all, where can I approach?
Okay, so you are saying second part. Fine. Mm-hmm.
Ma'am, first I have to prove, ma'am, but the second it is approximately done. But if I have to go first, where can I go?
So you see, you have saying that already the first part is done and you want to recheck that first part, is it?
Yes, ma'am. I want to recheck and prove it properly over there.
It's okay, it's a good thing, okay? But try for the reducing that. If it has taken 60 to 70 days, you do it for if you with some modifications,
we are trying
you can
to do it
reduce
with different pH level and pressure and oxygen variation.
You can optimize that.
Yes, ma'am. That's where when we start, we'll do it on that way. But the thing is, when I have to identify the enzymes and gene for the second approach of my project, where can I go for that, ma'am? Where is the proper place so that I can identify those all things?
Actually, there is genomic sequence will be there. You can get it outsourcing. Some institutes, it may be just, I don't know, ImTech is giving, but there are some private institutes in Bangalore and other places. They will be charging you. It is a little bit high amount. It will be around 10 to 12,000. They will be, but you can go for the gene sequencing there if you are getting a good result. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Now, for enzyme is the main thing, ma'am. Where can I get the enzyme?
You want to purchase enzyme, you are saying? Huh?
No, I want to identify the enzyme.
So enzyme, in plastics, basically, it may vary, okay? As you are telling you, it's PP, yours is PP. What is the substrate you are having? You are thinking?
It did PVA, but we are going to try with different ways.
Okay, PVA. Nay, but for that is still unknown, na? So their mechanism you try, okay?
Yes.
Mechanism you try with a review. And another thing, normally this plastic degradation, we normally say that esterase enzyme, then monooxygenase enzymes will be working, okay? Then some lacases also there, lacases, then some peroxidases, catalase. So these are some of the enzymes which will be normally general this mechanism where the enzymes involved with the plastic degradation. So, but in your case, no, it will be a little bit difficult, and you are in a undergraduate student. So I don't know, you are in third semester, third year or fourth year? Which year?
Ma'am, I'm in third semester over there.
Third semester. That means you have having three more semesters.
No, ma'am. Yes, third year is over there. Fifth semester.
Okay, third year. Third year. Okay. You try it, but you don't have much time. You have the classworks also, na? So you, as per you discuss with your supervisor and then finalize, because the enzyme it would be a little bit bigger. Work. Means it's time taking.
Yes, and that's
so
time taking.
So you do only the basic thing. Okay, basic this enzymes, basically what enzyme is involved, whether catalase is involved, spectro photometer readings like that, you go for that thing. Because if you enzyme extraction, then purification, if you are a biotech student, na?
Huh? Yes, I'm a biotech student.
Bye. So there you can go for STS page if it is available in your it's available in your lab.
Yes, it's available, ma'am, in our lab.
So that you can do. Whatever enzyme, crude enzyme you are getting, you can go for that STS page, and you can go for this molecular weight determination and all. Because right now, without enzyme characterization, you are not knowing which enzyme you are having, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
PV. So that is, it's a trial and error. In biology, you won't get every the answer for your question. Your question won't be answered. So there you have to find answers. So many times it may be wrong. But you have to do again and again. But that you don't have time. Is it?
That time is a problem.
Time is an issue. So you discuss with your supervisor. So they may be more knowing. They can. Some students may already worked on that thing. So you can cut there, or you can get more idea from there. So there, that way you can reduce your time.
Ma'am, one another more important question, ma'am. Like the recent trend on industry, like I have seen environment industry from last 2 months, I think, ma'am. From there, I am talking and consultant over there. The major problem right now I saw over here is the bacterial degradation of the plastic or such kind of waste. Most of the people have not seen also. And the biodegradable plastic, which is present in our market, actually, when I went through the research paper, it is been decomposed in the industrial way only, where we have to provide high temperature as well as high pressure for the degradation, ma'am.
You see, the one which we are having, for example, you know, biodegradable plastics, what we are saying, na, there are different types. I told you, it's not only the microbial bioplastic, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
What you are getting in the this market is starch-based. It's basically starch-based one. Okay, so that is made from your cornstarch or some other thing, is it? And you know that one definitely, if it is added some additives to it, it takes time. You know about earlier, some of you may be eaten food in plant-based plates, is it?
Yes, ma'am.
Banaya hua peepal ke patte and all.
Yes, ma'am.
So that is degradable. That is degradable, but it has limitation. What is the limitation there? If you pour gravy and other things, it will be falling, is it? So in order to overcome that limitation, then we come up with the thermocol based thing, is it? So wo to aa gaya, wo to cover up ho gaya. But this one, this plastics which you are saying, why it is delayed? Because it some additives or plasticizers may be added. Normally, sorbitol and all you have it in it. So it may be the reason that nobody says na ki marketing is one of this one is they won't say what they have added. They will be saying that it is biodegradable. But it, you know, there are certification. There should be certification for that one. And maybe compared to your plastics, I told we have seen that it's around 1,000 years. Sometimes it even more, you know, decomposition. This one it takes time, but it may be few months may take. And temperature, you know, If we are talking about the degradation or decomposition, you know that during winter and during summer, the decomposition varies.
Yes,
is it?
Yes, ma'am.
So, because this biological action, that is mostly environment related. So, if you don't have the conditions there, or if you change little bit, it is delayed. So it may be the reason which you are saying, the one which is available in the market, it won't be degradable soon, or it takes some time for degradation.
Ma'am, main question is, ma'am, why isn't India looking for the microbial level of degradation and all for production? Means I have gone through some research where a plastic are being produced by microorganism only, and they need to just keep the methane for the growth of the plastic. So they make plastic over on such biodegradable plastic on foreign countries like US and all. Why isn't India focusing on that way of production of plastic and degrading the plastic by microorganism, which can be the,
you know, you just see in India, in the Indian context, we have our the commercialization, that thing we are doing R&D, but we have limitation, but still we are doing that research. Okay, but once that research to that market or the commercialization, what support we are getting from our government? You say for the research, most of us, even we are, for example, you are having a good proposal in your hand, but funding, and once funding you got, how can you check it pilot scale? So these are some of the limitation which we are facing. Maybe in the coming time, the DST and other departments, they are working on the some proposals where they are giving pilot scale, even they are funding for the pilot scale studies of the one which already proved success. So maybe in the coming time, the commercialization may be there. And one more thing is that Indian economy, for example, you yourself, if you're going to buy something, what is in your mind? How you will be save money, is it?
Yes,
कि कैसे अगर बार्गेन करो या जो भी हो, थोड़ा सा होता है. तो हम अगर सपोज यू आर गोइंग टू द मार्केट एंड यू वांट ए प्लेट, आपको प्लेट चाहिए. सो आप देखेंगे बायोडिग्रेडेबल वाला लिखा तो है, तो बीइंग ए साइंस स्टूडेंट और आपको लगता है कि ये लेना है, बट आपके पास ओनली 50 रुपीज है. आई एम गिविंग वन एग्जाम्पल, सो 50 रुपीज है एंड दैट इज कॉस्टिंग अराउंड 60 रुपीज, सपोज 60 रुपीज एंड यू आर गेटिंग 60 रुपीज में आपको एक या दो मिलता है. I'm just giving, this is not exact figure. While in the plastic one, you will be getting 20. You are getting the difference. So, our mind usi se ye kar dete, aur hum, we will go for that.
Okay.
So, once our cost be reduced, ho jai, equal, ho jai, then we will think for that. And you know, nowadays, jise organic farming ko ye dete hai na. Earlier, hum log organic farming, we changed to conventional that farming. Now, we are again coming back to organic. बट ऑर्गेनिक वाला कितने लोग एफोर्ड कर पा रहे हैं इंडियन में, इंडिया इंडियन कॉन्टेक्स्ट में?
इट्स एक्सपेंसिव मैन,
है ना?
यस मैन,
या सो दिस इज आवर लिमिटेशन. बट इन यूएस एंड ऑल यू सी देयर इकोनॉमी इज लिटिल बिट डिफरेंट. ओके, सो वहां पे इफ यू सी ओनली फ्यू फ्रैक्शन द प्रोपोर्शन यू कैन से दे आर ओनली लाइक अवर्स. बट हमारे जो मेजर ग्रुप है, जैसे मिडिल क्लास है हमारा यहाँ पे ज्यादा, मिडिल एंड द बिलो वन, सो दे विल बी लुकिंग फॉर ईच एंड एवरी पेनी, व्हाइल ओनली द हायर क्लास इज इन द स्मॉल प्रोपोर्शन. व्हाइल इन द यूएस ऑन द डेवलप्ड कंट्रीज यू कैन से दैट दे आर इन द बिगर ग्रुप, सो देयर मार्केट वॉन्ट बी मच इफेक्टेड. इफ ए न्यू प्रोडक्ट कम, दे विल बी ट्राइंग दैट वन, बट नॉट इन अवर्स. ओके आयुष,
ओके मैम, थैंक यू मैम.
Ma'am, is there any way microbes can be useful to us in pulling out the greenhouse gases from our atmosphere?
From atmosphere, you are saying, na? Huh?
Yes, ma'am. Or Rishabh, like in any other
is it,
process?
Is it Rishabh who is speaking? Rishabh?
No, ma'am. Sai Teja.
Okay, Sai Teja. Okay. I told you, na, this is one limitation in air. Air, if it is a controlled air, for example, atmosphere. We are having, you heard about OTC?
No, ma'am.
Open top chamber. Huh? So it's one of the chamber where you can collect the greenhouse gas for the estimation, okay, whether carbon dioxide, methane in particular area. It's not so, for example, I'm taking a sample from here, from my room, and I'm taking a sample from my outside, outside my house. Do you think these are same samples? I'll be getting the same thing?
No, ma'am.
No. Okay. One thing is that thing. Another thing, we need to culture it. Okay. What you are doing, organism, microbes. Huh? Microbes, what is the basic step? Whatever we are saying, whatever product or whatever this thing, your remediation and other things, what we are doing first? We know we have an organism, we have a microbe, a bacteria or whatever, we are having a bacteria. So we have to culture it. Now, culturing it, it's okay. Soil and water, you can collect it like in situ, ex situ is possible. Is it possible for air?
No, ma'am. Hmm?
So that is one of the limitation with respect to the air pollution. Now, there are some, but if you have, just say you have heard about trickling filters, you know about the primary, secondary treatments of wastewater. Suna hoga aap logo ne? Activated. Sludge treatment, wastewater treatment mein hota hai. You are having primary treatment, secondary treatment. Secondary treatment mein zyada der you are using the different microorganism based techniques. So here, if you are having this biofilters or trickling filters as a carrier, and we have some machineries in a particular area, some sort of it can be absorbed as a, you can say, just say you have heard about scrubber. स्क्रबर सुना है?
नहीं मैम.
स्क्रबर वो एक्चुअली ना जैसे बायोसॉर्प्शन सुना है? बायोसॉर्प्शन इज वन ऑफ द थिंग वेयर माइक्रोब्स यू कैन यूज डेड सेल्स एज वेल एज लिविंग माइक्रोब्स फॉर दैट एब्जॉर्प्शन. इट बायोसॉर्प्शन इज मेनली इट इज एब्जॉर्ब्ड ऑन द सर्फेस. द सेल्स इज absorbing it on the, like your activated charcoal.
Yes, you know, ma'am.
So there, if you are having any heavy metal, you are using activated charcoal, that is absorbed on the charcoal, carbon, is it? It is attached to that. It is physical attachment. Similar, yes, to that, if you are having any technique with this one, but it's not for the end air, because this air is always moving, okay? Soil, it is stagnant. And water, you can control the movement. I'm not talking about the flowing thing. I'm only saying about the standing, the lotic. Okay? Lotic, yes, lentic, suna hai na? So you are, this whichever is standing water, you can go for that, this type of in situ. Okay, but ex situ, you have to collect it. But here, in the case of air, how you will do that thing? If you are doing it only with the help of some, what I'm saying, the filters and other things, some with the help of some organisms, they are capable of absorbing that particular that gas. It's only for that particular area. Then the air will be moving. It will be moving. So it still now, we don't have such mechanism for that. But still R&D is there. Because, you know, if you have a challenge, you have to go for that and you have to find out the solution. Okay, so maybe in future, maybe you may be coming with that idea, Sateja. Yes, you can, ma'am, think about it. So, but sure, right, ma'am, now, this is the limitation. So you can work, okay, on, ma'am, that. For example, if we are having, and one more thing, that emissions, we don't know how much height it will be going, is it? So if you want to take it out, you have to do it at the source level. Basically,
yes, ma'am.
The source itself, and that is mainly with respect to your industries. Okay, then landfill is one of the good idea. Landfill gas you can collect. What we are saying now, so that there your methane there you can go for this organism for the, but not for absorption. Okay, the objective of your thing should be some with some value. Okay, you are simply absorbing it. What will be next? What will be doing air, where you will be culturing it, what is the media for their growth, what they are doing next. Okay, so these are the questions which you need to be think before going for that.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, like in laboratory for growing any bacteria, we always need agar. But anywhere else...
No, Divyansh Yadav, is it?
No, ma'am. With growth media, ma'am. Growth media, agar is the solidifying media, ma'am. On that... On bacteria should be means grown on agar with the growth media. But anywhere else, the... bacteria grown without the agar. So, ma'am.
Yeah, you know, this one is only solid media. You can also have liquid media without agar. Without agar, you can, for example, if I'm saying ethanol production, is it? Huh?
Yes, ma'am.
Ethanol production, if I'm saying ethanol is a liquid thing.
Yes, ma'am.
And I need to be make it in the, I'm making it on the fermentation media, which is a liquid. Broth media. Okay, you have heard about broth and agar media. Yes, agar is the one which is only for the solid. And normally the solid one, we do it for the counting. CFU, you may be done.
Yes,
colony forming units. So that one, that counting, or the if you want to isolate, screen something, so we go for that. But if we want the production, we never use agar in it. If you want to, if you want the product only, we know we have already screened it and we know that thing, and we can further go with this organism for the production. And that production, you know, the fermentation are of different types. Okay, one is solid state fermentation, another is your submerged fermentation. The liquid one, the growth one, is the submerged one. Okay, so there you will be having enough water. The liquid, and you will be, for example, if I'm taking the bioethanol itself, so your media, finally, you will be having the product in it, and you will be extracting with the distillation for this anhydrous ethanol production. So there you can't use agar is a salt.
Means the place from where we have taken the microbe, there was no agar, but in laboratory we use agar. So ma'am, that's,
you know, actually Divyansh, where you, for example, you have soil sample, okay, so you want to say that soil sample, you have the bacteria growing in it without any agar, is it?
Yes,
ma'am. So you see, this agar is not a growing media, it's only a solidifying media. There the organism is not using agar as a carbon source.
Yes,
okay. Ma'am. Here agar, what is its role? You have a, for example, you are having a petri plate. Okay. So petri plate, you have made a nutrient agar you take. Okay? So nutrient agar mein aap log pepton dalte hain, yeast extract dalte hain, glucose dalte hain, na? So ye jo cheez jab dalte hain, and you are adding agar. सो अगर का रोल है ओनली उस मीडिया को सॉलिड रखना. हाँ, वहां पे जरूरत नहीं है. और ऑर्गेनिज्म आर नॉट बोदर्ड वेदर इट इज ए सॉलिड और लिक्विड, दे आर बोदर्ड फॉर देयर सोर्स ऑफ कार्बन, नाइट्रोजन. ओके, सो उनका व्हाट इज देयर जो न्यूट्रिएंट जो है कहां से मिलेगा. फॉर एग्जाम्पल माइक्रोब है, ठीक है, आपका एक प्लांट है, उस प्लांट को मैंने एक हेन था वो मर गया, तो आई पुट दैट वो जो डेड बॉडी जो भी था वो सॉइल में डाल दिया, ठीक है, एंड दूसरा मैं उसको चिकन 65 बनाया, जो भी बना के उसमें डाल दिया, या डिफरेंट फॉर्म्स जो भी अलग अलग इसमें डाल दिया. व्हाट डू यू थिंक द प्लांट्स इज टेकिंग, और विच वन दे विल बी प्रिफरिंग मोर? जैसे आपको कुछ प्रेफरेंस होता है ना कि आप ये ज्यादा पसंद करते हैं, वो ज्यादा पसंद करते हैं, है ना, बट अल्टीमेटली what your body is taking up, you know about the biomolecules, is it? Carbohydrates, protein, fats, is it? So same way, the plants are not bothered about whether it is a cooked chicken or it is a raw chicken. They are bothered about only the nutrients, carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium.
Yes, ma'am. So that's what I'm telling, that ma'am, in petri dish, we put the microbes and then the growth media. Why we use agar?
You see, आपको देखना है. Suppose microorganism. You define microbe. How you will define microorganism? How you will define microbe? Microbe क्या है?
I'm a living thing which needs nutrients for growth, and it metabolize.
No यार, अगर हमने देखो अगर माइक्रोब के डेफिनेशन करना है तो आपको ये बताना पड़ेगा एनी ऑर्गेनिज्म विच इज नॉट विजिबल टू योर आई फर्स्ट थिंग विच नीड्स ए माइक्रोस्कोप टू सी इज इट. अगर आपने प्लांट ग्रो करे यू कैन सी इट, आप देख सकते हैं है ना. बाकी आप देख नहीं सकते. नाउ इसको देखने के लिए हम माइक्रोब जो अगार वाला सॉलिड वाला फॉर एग्जांपल लिक्विड में भी आप ग्रो करें, सपोज ग्रो कर लिया आपने ठीक है, अगार नहीं डाला, यू कैन डिफरेंशिएट इट विद द टर्बिडिटी इज इट. इफ यू डोंट हैव एनी स्पेक्ट्रोफोटोमीटर यू कैन नॉट एनालाइज इट हाउ मच इट इज ग्रोइंग और हाउ मच ग्रोथ इट हैज इज इट, नहीं कर सकते. बट इफ यू आर डूइंग इट इन ए सॉलिड अगार मीडिया आप उसके लिए आपको वहां पे उसमें ऊपर ग्रोथ आ जाए है ना, तो ग्रोथ आ जाएगा तो यू नो दैट वन सीएफयू वन कॉलोनी फॉर्मिंग यूनिट कम्स फ्रॉम वन बैक्टीरिया सो यू विल बी इंटर वो कनेक्ट करते हैं. ओके सो वो हमारा एस्टिमेशन के लिए और स्टडी के लिए हम नॉर्मली ग्रो करते हैं उसके लिए. फॉर एग्जाम्पल अगर आपको एंटीबायोटिक की स्टडी करना है ठीक है, एंटीबायोटिक की स्टडी क्या होता है कैसे होता है, what do you mean by antibiotic?
Ma'am, antibiotics aise ma'am hota hai, microbes we grow the microbe on the agar, I mean petri plate with the agar, and then we put the antibiotic plate on the microbe ma'am disc, and there are different discs, and then we check the
growth. You will be inoculating the organism hai na, jaise aapne Alexander Fleming ki kahani to suna hi hoga.
Yes ma'am, yes ma'am.
So उस time तो क्या हुआ था, you know it is it, so yes, how he has came with that penicillin is it, so the same, so how अगर उसने broth में किया हो तो इतना clarity नहीं मिलता, so this is only for the study purpose. ओके मेनली आपका एस्टिमेशन के लिए ये ज्यादा अगर का बेसिक होता है. अगर आपको एंटीबायोटिक कुछ इस तो एक और चीज है, सम प्रोडक्ट्स ना आपको उसमें से निकालना पड़ता है, वो भी एक बात होता है. सो वो इन दैट केस यू कैन यू नीड to grow that organism in the agar only. Ki not always growth will work product ke liye, aapka product kis cheez ke liye hai, to uska aapka for example aapka ye antibiotics ka hi dono tarah ke bante hai. Commercial production hamesha liquid base pe hota hai, solid state bhi hota hai aur uske baad wo nikalte hai, so there are different techniques. This is one वे जैसे अगर में तो आपके केस में आपको स्टडी करने के लिए करते हैं. इंडस्ट्रीज में भी अगर इतना बना के सर सोचो कि आपको मतलब हाई अमाउंट में प्रोड्यूस करना है, तो आप अगर अगर में करें तो आपका कितना स्पेस यूज हो जाएगा है ना. दिस इज हॉरिजॉन्टल एंड वर्टिकल, सो यू जस्ट इमेजिन, सो देर आर लिमिटेशंस इन दिस इफ यू आर ग्रोइंग इन द अगर मीडिया. इफ यू नीड ओनली स्मॉल अमाउंट यू कैन ग्रो इट एंड यू कैन हैव द प्रोडक्ट, बट वो एक्सट्रैक्शन वगैरह थोड़ा सा अलग तरीके से होता है. यू नो अबाउट एनएरोबिक ऑर्गेनिज्म भी ग्रो कर सकते
हैं. हां मैम, इज देयर एनी अल्टरनेट ऑफ अगार मैम, मैम इफ यू वांट टू ग्रो इन होम और समवेयर.
एक्चुअली अगार का सॉलिड की बात बता रहे हो ना, सॉलिड अभी तक मतलब मुझे आइडिया नहीं है बेटा कि आई हैव ओनली यूज्ड अगार ओनली.
यस मैम, आई हैव आल्सो बीन ऑन द अगार.
हाँ, क्योंकि आपका माइक्रोब्स की केस में जितना भी सॉलिड मीडिया है यू नीड अगार. अभी तक कोई अल्टरनेट आया नहीं है अभी तक. मे बी आने वाले टाइम में कोई और करे चीपर देन अगार.
ओके थैंक यू.
ओके
सो रिजल्ट, दिस इज द लास्ट. इफ यू डोंट माइंड
डन नाउ.
या या वी आर डन
मैम.
Okay, actually, I thought that you may be aware, so I just skipped it. Okay, this is not the limited one. Means the one, for example, so first one was the biodegradation, is it? So biodegradation, for example, we were discussing about the mineralization. Remember, ki that is quickly degrading to for ultimately what will be the product? Carbon dioxide and H2O. Okay, so the biodegradation can be complete or partial. So that is one case. So they are converting that to this form. Now, in the second was the biostimulation. I don't remember the order, but it's biostimulation. For example, you are having some native strains in that contaminated area. So what you are doing, you are stimulating it. Stimulating it means with help of some nutrients and all. Nutrients you are adding, you are supplementing that area with some particular nutrients. So you are adding media. For example, I'm giving media with MS mineral salt media, jo bhi hai, aap add kar rahe so that the organisms multiply. And your degradation will, means that remediation will be faster. So that is biostimulation. And you have biosorption, I told you. For example, you are
Biosorption, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Biosorption, for example, I'm having wastewater, effluent, industrial effluent, okay? So in industrial effluent, I'm having that some, arsenic, yeah, some other heavy metals in it, okay? So I want to remove that. So I'm having some bacteria which is able to absorb it, okay? So that is biosorption. So, and once it's absorbed, the water will be pure, not pure, but it is treated. You're getting? So it is absorbed. Where it is absorbed? It can be in the cells. And these microbes absorb it inside. Okay. Then the bio-venting. Okay. Bio-venting and bio-sparging are almost similar, but a little bit difference is there. Bio-venting, you are giving aeration, oxygen. You are giving aeration to that particular area for where the indigenous microbes are present, and you will be, it's a sort of simulation only, but here we are not giving the nutrients, we are giving the oxygen. Okay. And in the case of biosparging, we are giving both. We are inoculating as well as we are giving oxygen as well as the nutrients. Okay. So these are different terms with respect to this bioremediation. I thought that you may be knowing, so I didn't waste time on that. Okay, it's clear?
Ma'am, biofilm.
Biofilm?
Biofilms.
Yes, ah, biofilms, huh? Actually, some microorganisms are capable of producing this. It's a layer, especially... Your voice is breaking, so I'm not getting.
No, ma'am. I was asking that, do we have any advantage of biofilm in the environment? We know the disadvantage, but we don't know the advantage of it.
Yeah, you have the advantage. Biofilm, for example, some organism, microorganism produce biofilm. For example, your oil, your polyaromatic hydrocarbons and crude oils, bacteria, they produce biosurfactants. You heard about biosurfactants?
Yes, ma'am.
They can produce biosurfactants. It can be EPS, exopolysaccharides. Huh? So they will be. It will be helping them to make the your organic molecule or that inorganic molecule available to the organism, microorganism. So it will be more available with the help of this biosurfactant. This biofilm also. Biofilm also increases the or enhances the bioremediation. Excuse me.
Okay,
so
ma'am.
It has positive. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Dhanya. I think we took you a lot of time. But
no, it's fine. But I'm worried for the next. They have next session?
No. We don't have session.
Okay.
Yeah. So thank you so much, Dr. Dhanya. And that was really wonderful to have you. And it was really interactive and informative. We always look forward for your contribution and support for a future workshop. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am.